You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Is everyone excited to be at Star Wars Celebration?
My mind exploded.
Star Wars has the best fans.
This is amazing.
It's an incredible family experience for a lot of people.
It's awesome.
Awesome.
So awesome.
No. No. No.
Yes.
Daddy, listen.
Live from the forest moon of Endor, Radio Free Endor. Star Wars Podcast, bringing you news and reviews from the galaxy far, far away.
Hello and welcome to this special episode of Radio Free Endor, and we are counting down the days to Star Wars Celebrations Orlando. And if it's anything like London last year, then you're all in for an amazing time as Celebrations just keeps on getting bigger. Now today we are focusing on a Star Wars artist, Brian Miller, who will be showcasing his exclusive print for Star Wars Celebrations Orlando entitled Star Wars, 40 Years of the Force. I am your host, Jamie, and it's with great pleasure I welcome Brian Miller. Welcome, Brian, to the show.
Oh, thank you. It's so nice to be here.
It's great to have you. And can I just say thank you for reaching out to us to showcase your artwork on the show.
Oh, well, I always like to speak about the artwork, and anytime I get to talk about Star Wars is a good time.
We always like talking about the wars. That's the main thing about our show. It's all about the wars. Now, can I ask you a bit about your background? How did you get into being a Star
Wars
artist?
Well, I started in comic books. And at a comic book convention, I met a science fiction artist named Joe Corroney, and I'm sure many of your listeners will be familiar with him. His work's been featured in Star Wars Insider and Star Wars comic books and Topps trading cards and all sorts of things. So he's pretty well known. And we really hit it off. So for a number of years, he was like the Jedi Master, and I was the young Padawan learner. I would do the digital color and paint for the majority of his artwork. And at a certain point in time, he had sort of asked the powers that be. He's like, I think, you know, Brian does a lot of really cool illustration work. Maybe we got to see if he could do something on his own. And they gave me a chance. And this was several years ago. The event was called the Acme Alliance event. And it was like a 24-hour special poster sale. And I sat down and I drew up this sort of propaganda-ish thing with AT-ATs and snow, and it was called Crush the Rebellion. And I turned it in. I was on pins and needles, and I was nervous. And they sort of came back and said, we're not really sure if Star Wars fans are going to like this or not. It's a little different. It's a little retro, and we just don't know. And they said, but we'll include you in the event. And so I was really excited, but also very nervous. And the event went live, and it sold out almost immediately. So they said, well, there's clearly an audience for this your point of view of Star Wars. So that's sort of where I made the transition from the Padawan to, well, I won't say I'm a full Jedi or anything like that, but but I'm definitely sort of on that path now. And it's been several years, and I've enjoyed a couple of celebrations, and here I am now.
That's great. Well, I'm just looking at your Crush of the Rebellion print, and I have to say, I love these propaganda posters that you've done, because you've done Crush the Rebellion, and you've also done Defend the Death Star and Protect the Empire. Now, would these be Star Wars, Empire, and Jedi?
That's correct. Yeah, the original trilogy. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, and I have to say, I love the Defend the Death Star because it's based on Endor, really. and I love the colors on it. It's absolutely fantastic. It's a stunning piece of art.
Thank you so much. Obviously, if anyone who's seen my art can tell that I'm inspired by vintage things and by artwork from the past and propaganda, old travel posters, even things farther back like Art Nouveau. And I just try to take all the things that I love and then let that influence my Star Wars artwork and try to do it in a way that feels right and feels natural. And so with those three posters, I really wanted to keep them really clean and just sort of reduce everything down to the most simplest of forms and let the detail be implied and just sort of, you know, let everything become more symbolic or iconic and let that be what carries the illustration. And if you like those pieces, knock on wood, there's a new piece in that series, a new illustration based around Rogue One, that if all the pieces of the puzzle fall into place perfectly, will also debut at Star Wars Celebration Orlando.
I'd be interested to see that. Well, I'm actually on the website. Is it your website?
So that is the website of the company that has the exclusive licensing rights to sell the artwork online. And so they're the license holder for Lucasfilm, and they sell the fine art screen prints that I illustrate and other Star Wars artists illustrate online.
Okay. Well, I was just looking at it, and not only have you got Star Wars ones, but you've got various other things, like a couple from The X-Files and one of my favourite horror films, The Fly. But I love how you've done The Fly one, because it reminds me, as soon as I looked at it, I thought, oh, he's done the original Fly, but it's like Cronenberg's Fly, but in
old
style.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of was my take on it. So it's for the 30th anniversary of The Fly. Fox Studios wanted to create some limited edition artwork, and they contacted me and a few other artists to come up with ideas. And I said, well, I kind of want my take on it to be a 1950s sci-fi take on the 80s film. And so I just tried to approach it from that direction and let that sort of concept guide me. And it was really fun. I was definitely out of my comfort zone, but I love the film. It's a little gory compared to like some of the artwork that I normally do. So I had to sort of figure out what elements from the film I wanted to incorporate. But in the end, it was really fun to get to play in that sandbox and with those characters, and really even just to get to illustrate the telepod. I mean, I'm such a geek. I just geek out on all the technology part of it.
Do you know, funny enough, I do. I absolutely love them. And when they released the box set of The Fly, in the UK this was, they actually came in a case that was the telepod pod, and you open it up and the DVDs were inside it. And I've always
kept
that.
Amazing. Yeah, I mean, that's the kind of stuff I think that excites me, and it obviously excites you. And I think, you know, a lot of the artwork that I create, I try to focus on the elements that inspire me or that I geek out about, because I know if I'm in love with it, then odds are that my fans are as well. And I try to stay true to that. So, you know, there may be an opportunity for some project come along, and if I don't really feel right about it, then I may have to turn it down or walk away. But when it's something like The Fly or The X-Files, like you said, I love those properties, and so I can get really excited about it and dig into the history of it and hopefully come up with a unique point of view that's a little bit different than what anyone else is doing.
I tell you what, I do like these posters, especially the X-Files ones, and I could just see them as like exclusive covers for the DVDs, but these would look smashing in a DVD case. And do you know your one that says the truth is out there? When I first, as I was looking through it, I actually thought that was the vintage poster for a very old film called Triantula. And I thought that was it when I first looked at it. Then I read The Truth Is Out There, and I thought, oh, it's X-Files.
So yeah, the inspiration for that piece was an old War of the Worlds poster. So I really tried to go for that like 1950s sci-fi retro vibe and then bring the X-Files into that. And yeah, that was for the new season that they did over here. I don't know if it aired in the UK or not, but
yes, it did.
Oh, okay.
Yes,
great.
Yes.
So when Fox had seen some of my Star Wars art, and they said, we'd like to invite you to do something for the new season, and they had sort of an outline of what they thought I should do, and I kind of wasn't feeling it. And I said, well, what I really like to do is like a 1950s science fiction, almost like a B movie kind of thing. And they were a little unsure about it. So I worked up like 8 different concepts, and they chose the two that you're looking at. Mm-hmm. And it was really fun to do. And I think at the end, they were really excited about it too. So they did like a red carpet event in Hollywood. And so my art and then some of the other artists that they had selected was hanging there on the red carpet as all the stars walked in for the premiere of the new season. So it was a really special thing to get to illustrate something that I love, because I grew up with X-Files, and then to sort of be able to put a little bit of a different spin on it and have Fox still be like, yeah, that's cool, we want to run with that.
Yeah, it'd be amazing to see them as like a big banner. That'd be amazing. Now, I also looked on, you've done quite a lot of Ziggy Stardust as well, the variant ones of the different colour. Now, of course, Ziggy Stardust, which is David Bowie's alter ego, it's just an iconic look and picture that you've used on that, and the colours are really striking. Can you tell me a bit why there is why you got two variants on the original?
I mean, I honestly, the blue and red version was sort of my original take on it, and again, it's for the anniversary of the original release, and I think that when Dark Ink saw it, or maybe when the rights holders to Ziggy Stardust saw it, they were in love with it, and they said, can we do an alternate color variation on this to make something that's a little more exclusive? So we have sort of like a main version and then a couple of variants. So the variant one actually has a glow in the dark ink, which they didn't even tell me they were going to do. So it was really cool when I got to see it, because some of the stars and the motion lines in the background and his eyes and different things glow when you turn out the lights. And so it's really sort of fitting to the time period. And then the variant two we did with like almost like a psychedelic color scheme, which I also think is fitting. So we sort of have everything for different types of collectors. We have like a very straightforward Ziggy Stardust poster and then the two variants. So if it's a more discreet collector or someone who maybe wants like the more psychedelic, they can get that. But that was really, I think, Dark Ink's idea, that they liked the illustration so much that they thought there would be enough demand to go and create a couple different variations on it, which was fun for me, because sometimes when you draw something, you know exactly what color scheme you want to use or exactly how you want to look. And when the client comes back and says, well, what could you do different with this? Then you sort of have to step outside of yourself and think about, you know, how it could be different. And it's a new challenge, and you have to be more creative that way.
Mm, yeah, I must admit, they are very, very striking. And especially now you just said that some of them glow. I'm thinking, yeah, I'd like that on my wall. Well, in fact, everything that you've got here, I would like on my wall. But like I was telling Jason W. Chrisman the other day, I'm running out of space on my walls. Now, that brings me on, right, to your exclusive print for Star Wars Celebrations Orlando. Now, congratulations first for being picked to be in Celebrations, because I've been chatting to Jason and he says there is a lot of artists submit different artwork and some have actually just been turned down, as in like it's not that good. Like Jason and yourself, you've been picked, so congratulations.
Well, thank you.
That.
I mean, I never take it for granted. I've been very fortunate to have been included in three Celebrations now, but I know that there's no guarantees, and it really doesn't have anything to do with how talented an artist is or isn't, because the pool of artists are all, you know, already authorized by Lucasfilm to illustrate Star Wars. It kind of comes down to the concept and the content. So celebration by celebration, what it is they want to see changes. And sometimes it might be like using Jason as an example, or maybe Joe Corroney, if all three of us did something that was Death Troopers, they might only choose one. So it's really an honor and a privilege to be included, but I know that it's never a guarantee.
Yeah. Now, your piece, to me, it's proper vintage. It takes me back to when I was a kid and those original Star Wars posters at the cinema that would just get you raveled up and you can't wait for the film. And the image is just striking. But you've also included on the link you sent me that some close-ups of the actual print, and can you just tell me how you've done it, because it looks like, well, like a, you know, it's textured, it looks like a certain texture, like
sure.
A 3D-ish
so
texture.
I geek out about vintage printing techniques, so not only am I in love with retro art and vintage art, but also the way it's made. So for this particular piece, I'm so thrilled, I'm just giddy over everything you said, because my goal was to make it appear as something that could have been released in 1977, but yet not feel old-fashioned. And so I'm glad to hear everything you said. It just touches my heart. But with the printing technique, I'm doing screen printing instead of lithography, so that gives me the ability to go in a little bit more of a handmade direction. So the little dots and patterns and dithering is part of that printing process, where instead of like a mechanical process, we're simulating shades of colors with what they call a halftone pattern. So I make all my own halftones. So you might have one dark shade of blue and one super light shade of that blue green. And by using different percentages of patterns, create the illusion that there's four, five, six, or seven shades of those blues. And so up close, you can see all the little intricate details and dots and patterns. And when you stand back, you know, 1 or 2 meters, it all blends together and becomes all the different shades of colors.
It's absolutely fantastic, because I keep leaning into it and leaning out, and it's really, really striking, especially with the falcon. And how do you, let's take you back to when you decided to do the print for Celebrations. Did you have, you know, different ideas, different scenarios, or did you sort of have this idea of the trench and the X-wing and the TIE fighters, or did you go through different versions of this?
I kind of sketch out maybe a little tiny thumbnail drawings in my sketchbook, maybe, I don't know, 8 or 10 different drawings. But I knew I wanted to do something with the 40th anniversary of the 1977 release of Star Wars. So I went back. As much as I know the film, I watched it again and again just to refresh myself. And this scene with the trench run just kept calling to me as the thing I wanted to draw. And one of the things I noticed about the scene is when you watch it in the film, you do see Red 5 in the trench. You do see the TIE fighters and Darth Vader's TIE chasing the X-Wing. And you do see the Millennium Falcon show up and sort of save Luke towards the end of the film. That's a really pivotal scene. But you don't see all three of those things in one composed shot in the film. So that struck me as something that I wanted to illustrate, because I try to make a lot of my illustrations things that either happen between the movies or things that you didn't see on screen. So with this, you'd never actually see on screen all three of these ships in context in one shot. So I knew I wanted to draw that, so I started sketching that out. And that was kind of the inspiration. And then from there, I knew I wanted it to feel like something that could have been released in 1977. So if you hang this up in your home and have a friend come over who's not a hardcore Star Wars fan, they might look at that and say, oh, that's a really cool vintage Star Wars poster. You know, where did you track that down at? So just to have that vibe that it's authentic and original, but at the same time, try to do something fresh. And so that's one of the reasons I did the really thick white border with the X-Wing sort of coming out at you. So the idea is that it's leaving the historical, it's leaving 1977, it's coming right into your home, right into your living space, and right into your life.
That is really cool. I'm just, because I'm constantly just looking at it in the, you especially with your blues, the way you've done it, it really does give you that three-dimensional look on the trench, and the X-Wing looks perfect. I mean, but the whole thing just looks perfect. You know what I mean? It is one of those posters that would gladly just put up. In fact, I'd probably take down a family picture to stick this one up. You know what I mean? If I was running out, should I do the kids or the posters? That's how the poster goes every time. But it's absolutely a stunning piece. So when you did it, how many times did you have to submit it for to be viewed by Lucasfilm? Because sometimes you submit it and they go, can you change this and this, and you take it back and you do a bit and you send it back until they go, yeah, absolutely, that's fine. Did you go through the same
kind of process? Well, there's definitely been times that I have been in that situation. I'm very fortunate with this particular illustration that they felt about it the same. Lucasfilm people liked it the same way that you do, and I think feel the same way about it that I do. So I was lucky. I got the green light with the first draft. And then for me, it's just taking it to that final stage and pushing it as far as I want to push it, so that it, you know, the initial draft, the initial drawing looks good, but I'm I'm probably my own worst critic. So, you know, I wanted to take it. I guess I wanted to feel like it was worthy of the 40th anniversary of Star Wars. And I think I achieved that. I hope I did.
Yeah, you did. Properly did. I've been viewing some of the other artwork on the Star Wars feed that's been showing up. And a lot of it is what I would say, and it's not a criticism on any of the artwork that is, because it's all beautiful artwork, but it's a lot of stuff that I would say was on the front cover of a comic book, if you know what I mean, where this is totally something different. Even though it's retro, it's proper fresh.
Well, thank you. I mean, when any of my art, whether it's Star Wars or something else, my first goal is, I think, is this something that I would want to hang in my home? And I try to think of it in terms of beauty. I don't know if beauty is the right word, but it's kind of the word that I think of, is that it needs to be attractive and beautiful and something I would want to see every day. You know, when I walk into my room, it's something that I would want to welcome me and greet me. And if I can't do that, then I don't want to do it. So that's sort of my foundation. And then I build up the sort of the geek elements that I'm in love with on top of that. So I really, that's sort of my ethos, and hopefully that's what I've achieved. I mean, that's what I'm going for, at least.
I think you have. What size is this, Brian? You know, what's the size of the
actual print?
So the actual
print is 12 inches by 24. I'll let you translate that into centimeters.
not too sure. I'll have to get it. We'll do an update on that later.
So, folks. But the good thing is that it's not too large that it couldn't go into some luggage that was going back to the UK.
Yeah. I'm going to see if I can get someone to bring one over for me, if I know anyone that's going, of course.
Well, I think I've definitely seen a few pre-orders coming in from the UK area, so I definitely think you've probably got some friends that are heading this way.
Oh, that'd be good. I wonder if I could get in their suitcase to go with them. My actual first celebrations was last year with Celebration London. That was the first time I had a chance of going to a celebration, and I thought to myself, I won't spend much. About 500 quid.
You lied to yourself, later. Didn't you?
Yeah. Spent 500 quid, boom, on clothes, on hats, on gifts, on bags, on posters, on prints.
But it was worth it. Like, the fact that they were making those really cool X-Wing t-shirts with the Union Jack on it live while you stood there, that was amazing. Yeah. I was like, I don't care what it cost, I'm paying. I want one of those right now.
Yeah. I've got one. I've also picked up a Han Solo one that was in the gift shop. Now, when I went through the gift shop, there was, because I'm quite a larger lad, all the big sizes had gone. And I was like, what? This was like on the first day. This was in the morning. And all the larger sizes were gone. They were just small and mediums. I was thinking, well, I've been in that queue, and I can tell you now there's a good 100 people that want XXL. I'll tell you, there's hardly anybody that's small.
I think you have to get the small one and then just like cut it apart and sew it onto something else and just have it like a punk rock Star Wars t-shirt.
It's funny you should say that, Brian. I did a swap with one of the Star Wars Celebration crew. Do you know the people that were going around with the blue t-shirts with crew
sure.
on the back?
Yeah.
And I gave them a poster. I says, swap you this t-shirt for this exclusive poster. And they were like, yeah, great. I was like, great. And I said, what size are you? Because she had it. But she says, oh, it's extra, extra large because that's all they had. I was like, oh, that is my look. But when I got it, it was actually small. So that's folded up to be framed at some point.
Exactly.
But this is apparently going to be the last Star Wars for celebrations for a couple of years.
It seems that way. I know prior to the new films, you know, it was every 2 years and sort of alternated back and forth between America and Europe or America and Asia. So it kind of feels like maybe they're going back that direction. I guess we'll have to see what they announce while we're there.
And there'd be a lot to... when you think about it, I know it's a year between them, but what they accomplish in that year, it's got to be to a tight schedule because it's so much there. It'd be a nightmare. Logistics nightmare for me.
I can't even imagine. And, you know, now that Disney is the owner and the steward for Lucasfilm, the fact that they're going to have it there in Orlando with all the parks and have special nights at Disney and Hollywood Studios for Star Wars. I'm hoping we maybe get some sneak peeks at the new stuff they're building. So, I mean, we're all gonna geek out about it, and then who knows what else they'll announce. I mean, I was thinking, I was like, you know, Disney has parks in Paris, and they've got them in Asia, and they've got them all over. So maybe we'll get some celebrations in some of those places.
Yes, that would be. If it's in Paris, count me in. I will go to that one. But basically, I'm saving up my money for my trip to Star Wars Land when that's built. It'd be fantastic if they held a celebrations there, but I don't think it'd be big enough for the amount of people that'd be going through, wouldn't it? Because when you think about it, in London, there was absolutely, the queues were so long. You know, it was like just to get a burger, there was a sign there saying estimated queue time an hour, and I was thinking, what?
So yeah, the people imagine. who the fans who turned up for London, it was amazing, and the crowds were good, and I love everything that they brought out there, like the giant size TIE fighter and some of the other large props and ships, and it was one of the most amazing celebrations, and it was so great to meet people from London and all over Europe and everywhere else that came. It was really a great show, and that Excel Center is so large that it really handled the crowds nicely.
Yes. When they showed the trailer for this, well, the sneak peek trailer for Rogue One, it was the only time I've actually ever had to stick my head on the floor just to get a sneak peek at a trailer, because that TIE fighter was just in the way. I just couldn't look around it, and I was thinking, oh, I've got to see this trailer. Oh, I'll tell you what, it was absolutely a dream to go, and a fantastic experience. And you being, a veteran of the celebrations, you've been to quite a few, but you're just looking forward to
the next one. Yeah, I mean, I'm a fan for sure. So, I always share a booth with Joe Corroney, and so he and I, we're not stuck, but we're usually busy, so we're sort of there most of the day, and then we try to spend maybe the hour after the show closes or at the end or right before, you know, just running around seeing everything we can see. So like last year in London, I waited in line for all the props and the costumes and everything they had on display for Rogue One, and it was totally worth it, because just to get to see that stuff months and months ahead of the film debut and just be in awe of the spectacle and the new stormtrooper costumes and everything else, I don't know, it's totally worth it. And as a fan, if you have the chance to go to a celebration, don't hesitate, just do it.
Yeah, you've got to. I must admit that the costumes from Rogue One were just amazing. Plus, they even had the model of the Death Star. Did you see that?
Oh, it was right, amazing.
And I was looking at it, I was thinking, oh, God. So I was trying to get my phone in to get some right good pictures without the shine off the glass at the front. But absolutely amazing. And, of course, the film was absolutely amazing as well. I was totally...
Oh, yeah. I mean, my wife is an archaeologist, so we spend a good portion of our year in the Middle East. So we were in Oman, which is a country that's south of Dubai and the Emirates, and actually traveled into a city that had a cinema so that we could go see Rogue One on opening night there. It was us and maybe a couple of other English speakers there, but it was awesome. I mean, to see it opening night in another country, and I was blown away by the film, and I'm just counting the days down until it's available here digitally so I can watch it over and over again.
I've pre-ordered it on my PS4, plus I've also pre-ordered it as well on Blu-ray as well, but I was a bit gutted because I was reading up about it and they were saying that there's no deleted scenes whatsoever, and I was speaking to my co-host the other day saying to him that no wonder there ain't no deleted scenes, because if they did, it'd be
right. I mean, yeah, I mean, I have no idea what they did or didn't delete. As an artist, I can just say that I had, and not just me, I'm sure several of the Lucasfilm artist had created lots of illustrations ahead of time, and most of those just got sort of, you know, thrown in the bin because they made so many changes at the last minute that a lot of what we had illustrated was no longer relevant. So it would be very, very interesting to see a cut of the film before all those changes, or to see some of those deleted scenes. Obviously, I'm very happy with the film, how it turned out, but I'm just curious.
Aren't we all? There was a piece on Dark Horizons. They actually had an interview with Gareth Edwards, and he were talking about some of the scenes. To be fair, the film was quite paced. Now, I was never bored, and it never slowed down for me. It was constantly going until the ending. I was blown away.
Oh, agreed. And I mean, I won't give spoilers, but yeah, at a certain point in time, I think all of us in the theater sort of looked at each other and like, oh, they're really going to do this. This is really happening.
Yes. I thought that as well. Well, to be fair, if any of our listeners have not seen it, what are you doing?
Yeah, exactly.
Get out there and see it. Don't wait for it to be... Well, they've got to wait for it now on DVD because it's...
I traveled hundreds of kilometers through a desert with no roads to see it, so you have no excuses.
Yes. All I had to do was just drive down to another city and saw it with some friends. So, is there anything that you're looking forward to? Because I know a lot of you artists, you know, you talk and you swap ideas and that. Are you going for any particular prints? Do you collect other artists?
Yeah, I mean,
prints?
The good news is that most of us at Celebration will, if possible, we do a swap with one another at the end. Depending on if we've completely sold out or not. So there's definitely a few that I'm looking forward to for sure. And just the fellowship with the other artists, a lot of them I consider to be friends, even though we only see each other in person maybe once a year or maybe twice a year if you count like San Diego Comic-Con or something like that. So we try to get together for dinner if possible or something like that and just catch up because, you know, we're all tied together by Star Wars, but we're separated by space and the fact that most of us work out of our homes or our studios. So it's really fun to do that. And then I'm like everybody else. I want hopefully to get a chance to see the sneak peeks that are there and to, you know, a peek behind the curtain at what's coming up soon. And then on top of that, I try to volunteer my time for the kids' room. So I know this year we're going to do how to make a paper BB-8. And so we'll have a sort of like a printout that kids can color any sort of colors they want for BB-8 and then cut them out and put them together and have this little body spin. So that'll be fun. I mean, I try to just take at least an hour away from the booth and go and do that because I figure Star Wars has been really good to me and the fans have been good to me. So if I can give back and volunteer my time a little bit, I try to do that.
Oh, that is amazing. That's really, really great of you. I must admit, I spent some time around the kids' area just because there was so much going on, especially like with the Lego and stuff like that, which always attracts me. I think Lego, Star Wars.
It's a lot of fun. I think half the people we get are the adults who want to like maybe take a load off and sit there and color or draw or build something. And you know, it's a free thing once you're in the door. So why not go home with some goodies?
True. And for me, and my wife can probably tell you this is absolutely 100% correct, I feel like a child again. Whenever I go to these things and whenever I see a Star Wars film, it makes me feel like the first time my mum queued in the rain to see Star Wars. And it's one of the best feelings ever. And looking at your print certainly brought that back on for me. You know what I mean? It's always going to be special for me. I'm just thankful for it that it's still continuing on. Because for us classic fans, you know, there's a time that we thought that was it, no more, it was just finished. But now my kids are going to be seeing it and their kids are going to be seeing it. It's just going to be going on for
this is true and time. I'm like you, it always holds a special place in my heart, and when I hear the music I sort of, you know, maybe tear up or swell up or however you want to say it. It gets a little dusty for me and you know, I'm a fan through and through. And one of the good things about Disney taking over is that they know how to keep something alive in perpetuity and how to take care of the property and roll it out in a way that kids are going to like it and teenagers are going to like it and adults are going to stay with it. So they know how to keep it fresh and not old fashioned. And we've seen how well they've handled their own, you know, properties and films and cartoons and things. And now with the films and with Rebels animation, it just, you can tell it's in good hands and it's connecting with their bigger audience than it ever has, you know, at least in the last 20 or 30 years. So it's nice to be able to just sort of feel at peace and know that it's going to go on and on.
Yeah, you're certainly true on that one, because, you know, years ago I always walked around in a Star Wars t-shirt, and you would hardly see anybody in anything with Star Wars on. But now, you know what I mean? You see people in Star Wars t-shirts, Star Wars bags, they've got beanies, you know, blokes getting the wallets out with Star Wars on. And when I see it, it just puts a big smile on my face going, yeah, look at that. It's great to be a fan now.
Well, it's a bit ironic, isn't it? I mean, I think about things that I liked as a kid, like the X-Files or Doctor Who, I don't know, Star Wars, different kinds of sci-fi properties and stuff that I'd sort of get beat up on the playground for liking. It's the most popular stuff now, you know? So everything's changed and it's all topsy-turvy.
Yeah, you're right. You know, I'm with you on that one, Brian. There was many a time I took a punch to the face because I was a geek. Do you know what I mean? I really was, and I stood up for it. I'm so much a geek. I've even built a TARDIS in my garage.
Oh, really?
You can actually see it. I've one of my Facebook pages called The Tiny TARDIS. I built it for my son, and it's half-scale TARDIS. And I take it around to conventions in the UK because my wife, she makes cupcakes and cakes for the conventions. So I take that, and often the people who run the conventions, you know, say, how much do you want to bring it? And I said, no, it's fine. I'll bring it. I don't want anything about it for it. Just put it in the corner and let kids have their photos taken with it. Because sometimes when you go, they've got the big TARDIS. And when they have their photos, little kids can be sort of swallowed up by how big it is. If you know
right,
what I mean.
Right, that makes sense.
Where this small one is their size. Especially how there was an episode of Doctor Who where the TARDIS
Oh, that's
shrunk.
Right, yes.
Yep, and a lot of people thought that was the actual TARDIS from that episode. You know what I mean? And I just go, yeah. It was easy for me to just go, yeah, it was. You know what I mean? But it just looks like it, and I built mine first. So it's just a great time to geek out, really. Especially with, like, the X-Files coming back. And I think I've heard talk that aren't they going to be doing
I've heard talk. Season? I haven't got a confirmation, but it sounds like it's going to happen. So fingers crossed.
I do hope, especially when you've got programs like Stranger Things, which I absolutely adore.
Yeah.
You know, if Fox don't want to do it, then sell it to Netflix. Netflix, just boom, get it
That's
out
right.
there.
Go ahead, Netflix, make all the things.
Yeah, make everything that nobody else wants. I want Firefly.
Yes, let's do it.
Yeah, what a fantastic time to be, really.
Oh, yeah, there's never been a better time to be a Star Wars fan or any kind of geek because the world is our oyster now.
It is true. So, Brian, this print that you've got, I take it you can pre-order it. So they could just go along and pick it up.
Yes, so any person who is going to be attending Star Wars Celebration, or if you have a friend who's attending Star Wars Celebration, as long as it can be picked up in person, can pre-order it from my website. And we've got sort of a list of some of the numbers there that are available. We were allowed to have 250 pieces. So if you have a favorite number, or if you collect your birth year or something like that, you can see if that one's available. If not, pick your next favorite number. They're all numbered and signed. And then I also have an add-on if you want like a little, we call it a sketch remark, so like a little small sketch on there. I can do that for you too. Or if you can wait till we meet in person and tell me what you want. But yeah, you can pre-order it and then pick it up at booth 2810 at Celebration. I'll be there and my friend Joe Corroney will be there. And we'll have these exclusives. Then we'll have some of the other artwork that we've done to look at. And we can just hang out and talk about Star Wars. It'll be fun.
That'd be excellent. I think if I was going to choose a number, I would go for 113.
Well, now it's only limited to 250 pieces.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Yeah, so you could try to get 138 and then when you get home, add another one in front of it.
Yeah, you're right. Oh, I totally messed up on that.
That's a great idea, though.
Yeah, it shows you my maths are a bit crap. Yeah, but it's a fantastic piece, and I really do hope you do. You know, you
it would. I hope so too. I mean, you know, as an artist, it's not all wine and cheese and bread. You know, on in front of the Eiffel Tower, like you sort of think when you think about an artist. So we work really hard, It's up to the fans to sort of show Lucasfilm that they like what we do. And so when we sell a lot or sell out, then it tells them that our artwork is connecting with the fan base and that people like it. And so when you pre-order, you're telling Lucasfilm that this artwork is important and that you'd like to see more of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and plus, when you go, there's just so much choice, isn't there? Especially if you've only got a certain amount of money, but you want everything.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? If you pre-order now, then it doesn't have to come out of your budget on the day of the show.
I'd love to see, like, one big print, but with, like, a copy of all of the prints of what everyone's done. You know, like,
that's actually really cool. They should do that, like, the year after. Right. It'd be really cool to see, like, at this show, at Celebration Orlando, you should be able to get a poster that has all the prints from Celebration London and so forth and so on.
Of course, not full size, but a quarter of the size or so. That'd be really cool.
That's a great idea.
Yeah, it is. I shall submit it immediately. Stick it on that email straight to Lucasfilm, because I'm on talking terms with them now. They often send me letters saying cease and assist on stuff, you know what I mean? But it's great. I'll frame them, stick them on. Brilliant. So apart from this print, you can still order your older prints as well, can't you, from like that dark?
So that's correct. Most of my licensed artwork for Lucasfilm and Fox and others is available on darkinkart.com. They represent a lot of artists that create licensed properties, and so you'll see some from me and some from other people. So definitely go there and check out everything that they have. And then my exclusive, you can go to octopolis.com and see everything that I have there, or just for the exclusive, it's I'll spell it out, it's bit.ly/SWCO exclusive. So it's short. If you go there, you can see it, or just search for SWCO exclusive and I'll probably be the first thing that pops up.
That's fantastic. So Brian, where can our listeners get hold of you? Have you got like a Twitter or
sure.
a Facebook page?
Sure. I'm on Twitter at Octopolis Art. That's OKTOPOLIS Art. And then Facebook, if you just search for Octopolis, I'll show up. And Instagram, the same. If you search for Octopolis, I'll show up. So I'm on all three of those social media platforms. I'm always sharing art and behind the scenes and sneak peeks, stuff like that. So if you're into artwork and want to see Star Wars and X-Files and Doctor Who and cool stuff like that, follow me.
That'd be fantastic. Now, listeners, remember, when you get this this exclusive print, you will also get a certificate of
Hand-numbered and signed, and yes, a certificate of authenticity as well.
Yeah, and I have to say, you've included a little picture of your certificate of authenticity, and I thought, that's really nice as well.
Thank you. Well, it's the artist and designer in me. I just can't let anything go undone.
I know.
Well, it makes a difference, and I'm sure everybody appreciates it.
I know they do. Well, it's been absolutely fantastic talking to you, Brian, and I hope you have all the success at Star Wars Celebrations, and I hope one day that we'll get to meet up, have a beer. If it comes to London again, definitely we'll all meet up and have a chat, beer and pie. That sounds good to me.
Well, it sounds good. It was my pleasure being here, and may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you, too. Thanks a lot, then, Brian.
Thanks, Ta.
We must be cautious.
Well, that was a great interview I had with Brian Miller. And with me is Paul, who's just ran up from the depths of the AT-AT.
Hello.
Who's been... And he's been staring at this picture that we've had hanging on our wall down there.
Yeah.
And it could give us a quick rundown of what you think of this poster, Paul. What do you reckon?
Well, I think it's actually quite striking. It's got a lot of depth to it. It's very much like an 8-bit kind of texturing that's been used to help the picture stand out in certain elements of it. The actual channel that you fly through is very detailed with all the kind of, you know, jutty bits.
The trench, the way he's done the colours.
Yeah,
really different cool. kinds of blues. Yeah, it's a proper retro.
Yeah,
it's a proper retro feel. In fact, if you saw this on the side of an arcade, the original Star Wars arcade, you wouldn't think it was something new, would you?
No,
you'd think it was from there. You're right, it's very striking. And the picture of the Falcon itself looks like it's from an arcade machine.
Yeah.
It's very nice. Yeah.
It is good.
And Brian was a great person to speak to on this, and we can only look forward to having more artists coming on board,
yeah,
and talking about their artwork for the forthcoming show. I just wish I could go, Paul.
Yes, you know what I mean? Yeah. It can be difficult sometimes, you know, scheduling, and you know, and obviously life gets in the way, and children, yeah, and whatnot,
and money. Yes. Money gets in the way as well. Money gets in the way.
I wish it would get in my way, to be fair.
I wish it had come my way. That's for sure, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, that brings us to the end of this fantastic special episode of Radio Free Endor, where we've been showcasing the artwork. So remember, you can show your love for this podcast with an official Radio Free Endor t-shirt, which are available from TeePublic. Also, iTunes is the best place to download us, and while you're there, why don't you leave us a 5-star review? Because we like 5-star reviews. Yes, we do. But you can also reach out to us on our social media. So search for us on Instagram, Periscope, Twitter, and on Facebook, of course. We are at Radio Free Endor, and you can find me at Jamie_R_Burns. And Paul?
You can find me at CutandRun22 on Twitter, or at Paul's Tweets.
And our email is radiofreeendor@gmail.com. And remember, you can also get in contact with all of us and everything else of Southgate Media are at SMGPods. So that just brings us to the end of it. And goodbye, and we'll see you very, very soon for another exclusive Radio Free Endor podcast. Bye-bye.
It's awesome!
Awesome.
So